Hello, hello. Another day, another episode of the Casually Serious podcast, co-hosted by me, Fazal, and my friend Abhinav. And today with us, we have a very special guest connected all the way from New York. And that's Marcelo. So Marcelo, would you like to introduce yourself?
Hello, everyone. My name is Marcelo. As Faye said, I'm in New York City right now. I was born and raised in Paraguay, and right now I'm in America studying architecture in the same college as Faisal.
Mm-hmm. So, just in case anyone didn't know, we study at University at Buffalo, New York.
Correct.
And Marcelo studies alongside with me. So,
you both are in the same program. I'm expecting that, right?
We both doing architecture, and we both failing successfully.
Yeah.
So Marcelo, I know we had a talk a few months back when I was there at your apartment. We talked about the culture that you came through when you came to US for the first time, all right, from Paraguay. So explain to us a little bit of a background or a transition, you coming from Paraguay to US, and just a little bit of a background so that we could relate to it. How your school life and everything has been so far?
I guess I can start from like the beginning, just like general idea of Paraguay. So Paraguay is like a third world country. So first of all, like the first thing that comes out of there is like education is not as good as America. America is like, you know, it's like in many ways, maybe Paraguay has like, you know, some things that like make education better. Like, for example, there's no such thing as a multiple choice in Paraguay, which in my opinion makes people just more advanced. Like, you know, like
you're talking about the examinations.
So you having to memorize, you having to understand, you having to like remember words is, you know, better than having to remember a piece of something to give you the answer. You know, but in Paraguay, other than that, like, you know, I don't know if you guys ever heard it, but like literally kids go to school for like 4 hours from like 8 a.m. to 11, 12 in the afternoon, and then done for the day. So I grew up in an environment like, you know, where education was like, you know, a choice for people. Mm-hmm. And then there was people that like ended, like my grandmother only studied until I think freshman year of high school.
Okay.
Because she had to start working, you know. So education wise is completely different. You know, people over there, you know, like I was telling Faisal a few months back, people struggle, you know, people sometimes don't have any jobs. People feel like they're struggling. People work hard, but then in the end of the day, and during a weekend or something, like everybody stops working completely. They share with the family. And I think that's something very important to me. Because even though in America, everybody has money, not everybody has money, but like there's more money. There's more, you know, like it's easier to have an iPhone in America than in Paraguay, you know? But like people spend Saturdays and Sundays working, you know what I mean? Sometimes in like, in a daily basis, I see my aunt like 3 or 4 hours a week. And, you know, that's pretty crazy. So, you know, going back to the topic, like the transition from Paraguay to the US, in a way, people can say, oh, yeah, you went from a third world country to a first world country, like with a lot more opportunities and everything. And you should be happy and thankful. And I am happy and I am thankful, but there's just so many things that like still connect me to my country, because I think at one point a little bit old and I was still connected to my country. I was 11 years old, you know. Even now I feel like I want to become an architect. When I finish my studies, I want to gain some experience and I want to go back to my country and help the people in there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just a little bit of a background, I guess.
Mm-hmm. I think before we get into the meat of the discussion about having much more about the follow-ups about between why you came to US and the culture shock that you came, came to face, I think it's important to address why we wanted to invite you. Yeah. And the topic of culture shock, at least, has been very much limited to people coming from, at least, it depends on the way how it's depends on how vocal the particular person or the particular person from that community is. And culture shock has always been associated with Asians coming to US or Asians coming to any other country inferior to that.
Basically, people coming from the East to the West, yeah. Almost. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Coming from the East. But then Fazil was extremely intrigued and excited to know that any person for that matter, there's nothing like only the Asians or only the East, people coming from the East can experience such a culture shock. Any person from that matter, a non-Caucasian person for that matter, can experience a culture shock. And I think trying to experience a different language barrier altogether itself is a big deal. And I think Fazil was in big appreciation of the way you were able to maneuver those challenges early on in life. And
yeah,
I think we'd be really happy how you must have felt back then. And I know how patriotic you must also be, knowing that you would want to go back and contribute to the community. So yeah, I think I just wanted to say that was a really nice, thoughtful gesture from your hand. Yeah, hand.
And also to add to that, there is something also that is, you know, common between Indians and maybe, I don't know, I guess it's the entire South American culture, because I spoke to many people.
Family. Yeah.
Yes. So family besides culture. People from Paraguay, people from Puerto Rico, I don't know if I'm pronouncing the names of the country right, but people from this country is Guatemala. Right. All of these people have the family culture and everything. It's engrossed within them, running through the veins. And that's about the same culture. That's about the same thought Indians share. Right. And maybe that's also one of the reasons why I was able to connect with Marcelo much more easily than with anybody else, because we have same values and same thought process. But coming back to the question, Marcelo, you said that there were a lot of difficulties when you came from US, I mean, from Paraguay to US, there was a lot of sacrifice that was made, right? Would you like to shed some light on what is the main culture shock that you had? Was it the language barrier, or was it the values, or was it the lifestyle? What was it?
So technically everything you said was like a big war in front of me, you know, like, first of all, before anything, you know, like, you have to understand what's going on around you, and English is like, you know, so pretty much, I studied English, in my country for like 7 years, but because third world countries, you know, the education is not like that, good. I studied for 7 years, and all I was able to learn was like, hi, how are you? And then end of story, you know? So, you know, first things first, I had to, you know, first started speaking the language, you know, started with, you know, just going to like all English school. So like others start going to a bilingual school. Like, I know many people that go to a bilingual school just so like they can have a transition. Well, I started, the first 2 years that I spent in America were like...
So there's a bilingual school also, is it? Like a Spanish plus English kind of school, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, I know people that were like, you know, like having like a tutor next to them that was translating things to them. I didn't have that. I was just sitting there in a class and I was just looking at the teachers and saying, I don't know what you're saying, but okay.
That's me in architecture school right now. I don't know what you're saying, but okay.
So yeah, once I started like controlling English a little bit more, another problem was also like the lifestyle. So I went from, like I said before, having free weekends where I could spend with my family, you know, relaxing, enjoying. And then I came here, and then I was, I don't know if you guys ever, you know, heard, but like the American kid is like, supposedly is very busy, but for me, it is very miserable. So, you know, like, you know, kids in like 4th or 5th grade, they go into school like at 8 in the morning and they get out at 7 in the afternoon, you know. It's a very busy day, but you know, it's like they see their parents like 2 hours, 1 hour every day, you know. So that was another problem that I saw. I was always inside. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know if you guys also compare that, but like other countries, you know, you come outside, you run around in the background, in the backyard and everything. And in America, most of everything happens inside. That was also a big problem. And then last but not least, like Fiso said, it was of like, you know, the culture in general. So like I had this very bad experience that I want to share if you guys don't mind. Like,
go ahead.
When I was in middle school,
okay.
Like in middle school, like I was half of my middle school years, I was in Paraguay, and then the other half I was in America. Mm-hmm. So there was this experience like that I experienced in the end of coming to the US that happened in Paraguay. It was like this kid, like, you know, I think failed a class, and then next thing, you know, she was like very upset with the teacher and like said a cursing word to the teacher. Mm-hmm. And then she got kicked out of the school. Mm-hmm. I remember so well. Like she cursed at a professor, at a teacher, and then she got kicked out of the school, right?
Okay.
Right. Then I came to America. Then the same thing happened, and not even a call to the principal's office, nothing. Like the professor just completely ignored it. And then that's when I noticed that, like, you know, the countries are completely different. And one of them, like, if you disrespect your elders, then you're severely going to be punished. And then the other one, it's just like, oh yeah, teenagers are, you know, complicated and they let go. And I think that's right. Like one of the biggest problems in America, in my opinion.
Got it.
So from what I understand is basically, I was fascinated with the last point that, you know, despite the, I think the family culture kind of is mm-hmm. not as well defined in America, you're trying to say, mm-hmm. where the respect associated with elders is not as well established as those coming from our culture, at least. That's what I'm able to understand from what you're saying.
Yeah, like, even family, like I've seen families like that, you know, their kids are born here and they start yelling at, you know, their mom, their parents, like, mom, stop, or like, leave me alone, or like, shut up or something, you know. If I ever say shut up to my mom, I'm dead.
I'm not going to see you next semester then.
It's the same thing for that. It's the same thing. Yeah. If you don't come to our room or something like that, we are outside the room, will we? It's not like we're going to.
Yeah. When you said for the most part of when you went to US, was like you staying inside the room, was it mm-hmm. because you were just afraid to meet new people, or was it that what was the situation when you meant that? Because I wasn't able to get that.
So pretty much, like, you know, schools are longer, like I said in the beginning, schools are way longer in the US. So right. Instead of going to go from like 8 in the morning to 11, that, like in Paraguay, I was inside classrooms like 8 in the morning until like 3 p.m. Mm-hmm. And then next thing you know, I was having a transition to after school program, like, I don't know,
okay,
like helping with homework or using the computers or going to the library and reading, and those still happen inside. So, you know,
right,
most of my days were inside, you know. Like, I'm not saying I didn't leave a single minute of my life outside, you know. Maybe I'll walk outside for like 5 minutes, but the difference is just way big. Like in Paraguay, I will spend most of my days outside sitting, you know, breathing fresh air, looking at like animals, like chickens and stuff, like walking around.
You right. know?
And in America, right. it's just like buildings and buildings and, you know, always inside four walls and just completely different. Saying there's like different stages like that I had to go through. Like, first of all, I don't know if you're asking this, but like in the beginning, like when I got here, not speaking the language, being close at home and the four walls and barely seeing my family, first of all, I got a little bit depressed. So I was like, you know, crying very often, missing my family, even though I was with my mom, like, you know, I was still like very, very sad, very not used to it. And it took me around like a year or so to like start getting used to the American ways. Mm-hmm. Also like the language, you know, it was like, I just never had motivation to go to school anymore. Like when I was in Paraguay, it was like, sometimes I had motivation like, oh yeah, either to see my friends or either to play with my friends, or sometimes even, you know, just to look forward to the next thing that I can learn in the math class or in the science class or in the social studies class.
Right.
But then when I got here for the first 2 years, because I didn't know the English, the language, it was just like another day at the office, you know, like just another day closer. And then I guess in the end, it was all worth it, because I guess you guys experience this when you guys are learning new languages as well, not just me, but like it just feels so unique. Because it's like one day you're just like, you're just not understanding still. Like I compare it to like looking for gold or looking for diamonds. You know what I mean? Like one day you can still like be going down, you know, and you don't see anything. And then next thing you know, everything is in there right in front of you, you know? So that's how it happened to me with English. Like one day, like literally one day, I was like, still like, oh yeah, I still don't understand. And then the next day my ears is like open. And the next thing I was just like, wait a minute, I understand what you're saying. So like it is not easy at all, but it is very possible. Like the transition and the language and everything makes it so challenging. But in the end of the day, it just feels so good.
Right. So which class or which grade did you shift to US? You said at age 11, right? Which grade were you in?
No, I was in sixth grade.
Sixth grade.
So, so I finished sixth grade in Paraguay, but because the year in Paraguay ends in December, and then the US half of the year ends in December. They were like, "Well, you have to redo sixth grade."
Yeah. Right.
I have to admit one thing. I think me personally, I am studying in India. Like I'm studying in my native place back in India. The thing is, me trying to converse in the local language itself is a big culture shock, because I was born, like I mentioned, I was born in a different country. I spoke a different language. At home, it's a different language. In school, it's a different language. And conversing locally is itself a different language, like Arabic or any other language, right? Now, the point is, you are remarkably cheerful for what you've gone through. I'll admit that. You are very cheerful for, like, I have to really appreciate that. I think to go through a different culture.
Marcelo is the happiest person in Buffalo. But go ahead. What were you saying, Abhinav?
Yeah, I was saying, right? Like he has this thing of cheerfulness that lights up a person's day. I think that really is something, whether he knows it or not, I think he should know it. Now that I've not met him before, but I'm meeting him over the podcast right now. He has a smile that really lights up a person's day. I think Fazil can relate to it. That's why you both are friends. It makes...
Thank you. I mean, I always tell this to Faisal, like, sometimes we share those moments when we're just both feeling, like, very bad, because architecture is, like, one of those majors that, like, the professors are constantly, you know, throwing, you know, bad comments at you, telling you to get better and all of that. And I just always tell Faisal, like, literally about, you know, feeling miserable and just being serious, you don't get anything of it.
Yes.
So might as well, like, give it at least a fake smile and then keep going, keep working hard and then, you know, approaching the next, you know, level.
Marcelo plays the dad figure for me when my dad isn't there at Buffalo. So
Sometimes we get into big arguments with Faisal because he's like, oh my goodness, like the professor gave me a bad grade. And I'm like, come on, Faisal, like forget about it and then just focus on the next area. And then he's like, I cannot just ignore it. And then I'm like, you can't do anything about it anymore. You can't change it. You can only change the future. You cannot change the past. So
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you so coming about this? I think you mentioned Paraguay, and my limited understanding about Paraguay is that Paraguay is a very good footballing nation. So do you play soccer or football, whatever it's called?
Yeah.
You do?
Marcelo likes to call it football, even though it's known as soccer.
In
I
US,
know that
it's
much.
soccer, right? That's
Yeah.
what.
So you talked about the various cultural shocks and the language barrier that you had to face, right? And coming through that, of course, you did a great job defeating that barrier, getting into the American culture very well. And remember how the previous semester was called fitting in. So you've fit in very well with the American. And until you tell me that you're from Paraguay, no one would really say you're from Paraguay. So how do you tackle such emotions? And especially now that you've gone through such a breakthrough, how do you advise anyone else to tackle emotions in life or tackle any difficulties in life? What do you want to say to those people who are facing same difficulty as you are? To all the people who come to US, they face a lot of difficulty. They have language issues.
Yeah,
Some people have food
culture.
issues. Yeah, food in the East is more spicier or whatever. It's cooked differently or whatever. And remember how I had halal stuff that I had to eat, right? So everyone has their own thing going on. What is yeah? So what is the piece of advice, or how would you? What is the advice you would like to give? That you, because you give a lot of advice to us, to me especially, and I would like you to give some sweet advice to the audience or something.
I think a very good question to sum it up would be, what is the kind of advice you would give your younger self? Like, if you would have to go over it all over again, how would you advise yourself? I think
Yeah, that's a
to advise the better. Yeah.
better way to think of it.
So personally, I think what kept me, like, Faisal says I did a very good job. I think I could have done a better job, but I don't think I did a bad job. But I think what, like, leading me to the place I am right now, like I know the language, I'm used to the everything going on around me. I go to college, and it's all because I always have this one goal. Like life is sometimes like harsh. Like you don't always get what you want in life, but you will always get what you deserve. So if you put a goal like way ahead. So when I was in middle school, I already had the goal to go to a good school, to go to a good high school, and step by step. So first, when I didn't know the language, my goal was like, because there's this thing they do in America that, like, if you don't speak the language, so if you don't speak English, of course they're not gonna grade you on the English class or the social studies class. So they just give you like a letter that says that you don't count on that class. So the grade that they give you doesn't lower or doesn't make your overall like higher. So then my first goal was like to get those grades there. You know what I mean? I remember the first time I got a grade for my English class. I had a talk with my teacher. She was like, Marcelo, right now you have like a 75. But if you do these two assignments that I could give you, then you can get an A. And I remember I did those two assignments, and then the professor was like, oh yeah, right now you have like an 80 in the class. Like, and then it was my first time ever to, like, right now if I get an 80, I'm gonna be like a little bit disappointed. Goal by goal, after that my goal was like to go to high school. Then after high school was like, to get good grades in high school so I could go to a good college. Then at one point it was like to get into UB, to get into, my dream school, to go into a good architecture school, and so on. So just to summarize everything, I guess like there will always be like struggle, language, food, whatever you're struggling with. But if you put like a goal, so you say, once I get there, then this is going to happen. And then with the goal, you know, you put like a good thing. Maybe like you're going to go back to your country, visit your family, or maybe even just the feeling that you're going to feel accomplished, you know. Those are just things that like keep you, make you keep going, you know. Sometimes you feel like, oh yeah, once I get here, I'm just going to like stop because I'm literally just not going to have no motivation anymore. But once you finish that, and once you get something done and it's a big deal, then out of nowhere, you get way more motivation than you had before. And then it keeps going. So it's like a race, a nonstop race. And then what keeps you going is the big goals that you have in life.
So you tackled the English language barrier, right? So I know you knew few slang words that you taught me. Could you teach the audience or anyone who's watching this or hearing this a few slang language that you've recently learned or whatever you've taught me even?
I guess we can start with Faisal's favorite slang.
yes.
Go which ahead. Is there's this one thing that they eat a lot in New York City, which is just pretty much like bacon and then egg and cheese. Right. But then the way we say it in the city is just like bacon, egg and cheese.
Right. Let's play a quick game. Let's do something. You speak 2 to 3 words and me and Abhinav will try to imitate that.
Recognize it.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. All right. So, and then you give us the score points and then let's see. Okay. Let's see. All right.
Yes, you guys can just start with that one. Just say bacon, egg and cheese.
Bacon isn't cheese.
Yeah, we got that. Yeah, we got that.
All right.
What about you, man?
I said bacon isn't cheese.
No, man, you said it wrong.
Bacon, egg, and cheese.
Bacon, egg, and cheese.
Bacon, egg, and cheese.
Bacon, egg, and cheese.
Yeah, that's good. That's good.
All right.
And there's other funny words like. There's this one word that I use a lot and that Faisal like uses a lot too, but then like I think last semester he didn't use it at all. It's cap. So it's pretty much like the word cap, you will see it as like, you know, a cap that you put in your head, right?
Yeah.
But then and the way we use it in the city is like stop lying. Like when you say something and then someone says cap, that means they're telling you that you're lying.
Oh,
so it's let's like say you say
stop lying, don't fake it out like that.
Let's say you say, "Oh yeah, you're very good at soccer," and then I'd say cap. That stop means catching. That I'm telling you that you're lying.
Yeah, that's something I learned.
What else? Oh yeah, this is like a very confusing one. Like many of my friends still don't get it, but like when you're like very far from something or when something is like very far from your reach, you say that's deep.
That's deep.
Like, okay.
Like if you don't want to reach something or if you don't want to go somewhere, like let's say your friend is telling you, oh, let's go to the beach that is 2 hours away. And then you don't want to go. So then you just say, oh yeah, that's deep.
But what is that new word that you taught me last semester? About the that which means gangster or something, I forgot.
Oh,
what
yeah,
the word
yeah,
was.
Yeah. G.
Yeah. G. Yeah.
So I just kept calling Faisal like I just kept saying like, "Yo, G, let's go" or something. And then one day he was just like, "What does G mean?" And I was just like, "Oh yeah, it's just the initial for gangster."
Yeah.
I think you know a part of me is feeling Marcelo has you know these unique slang words which only he knows, and he just to break a laugh out of himself, he'll just play a joke on you like Yoji kind of thing, you know.
Marcelo is someone that he brings new slang words each semester, so we are probably expecting 1 or 2 new slang words by the time he comes in August. And when we see him next. So
all of this is like New York slang, is it? Only New York, you can only hear this in New York.
So yeah, most of it. Like right now I have like my best friends right now from the city. They're very involved into like UK stuff. So they like music from the UK. So then actually right now I'm learning some slang from the UK, but you know, that's something different. I guess like, you know, like going from place to place. So, you know, I like to just take not like the worst from everything, but like I just like taking things from like, let's say I take slang from the city and slang that I hear from my friends that are appropriate, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, just make it, you know, and mix it around and then make it me, you know? Like, Faisal knows this, like, I hate being, I mean, I love being different, you know? Like,
yeah, that's why Marcelo is the coolest guy as well, with being the most happiest person.
Like, if you ever wanted to, like, offend me very badly, just call me normal and I'll be very offended.
That was funny. That was actually funny, man.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Like,
how many normal languages can you converse fluently?
What happened?
How many languages can you converse fluently now that I can see that you speak English fluently? You must be speaking Spanish also fluently, right?
Like, he's teaching us Spanish. So, I can say that.
Yeah, actually, my country is bilingual, so we speak two languages in Paraguay.
Okay.
So technically, I didn't speak Spanish until the age of 5.
Okay.
So I used to only speak my native language. I learned Spanish when I was 5, and I learned English when I was 11. So technically, I speak 3. And
wait, what is your native language called in Paraguay?
It's called Guarani.
Guarani.
Yeah. Guarani. Yeah.
Guarani, okay. Right. So is it like a dialect of Spanish or?
No, it's completely different. It's like, I don't know if you guys know the history of South America, but like Indians used to live in South America. And then the Spanish and the Portuguese came to conquer the lands.
Mm-hmm.
So every single country located in South America, like Chile, Argentina, Peru, Colombia, Ecuador, Venezuela, Bolivia, all of those countries, like the Spanish just took over their natives and made Spanish like their native language. But for my country, it was a little bit different because the Indians that live in Paraguay are called Guaraníes. So pretty much comes from the language. And then what happened was that, like, because they were, they just never let themselves get controlled.
Mm-hmm.
In the end, when Paraguay got their independence, there was two languages that became official.
Correct.
Right. So Paraguay is the only country in
South America.
In America to be a bilingual. Like, I don't think the U.S. is officially bilingual, even though most of its people speak English and Spanish.
And Spanish, yeah.
The only official country in the world in America to have two languages is Paraguay. And I had the pleasure to learn it. You know, I speak it every time with my family, whenever we're in the train, or you guys can ask my roommate, Dominic, which is also good friends with Faisal. You know, when my family came to visit me, like, he was just completely lost. Because me and my family only speaking Guarani.
Okay.
You could also use that to your advantage almost when you want to speak code language, that when someone doesn't want to understand, you just speak that language.
Yeah, I mean, of course, we will never use it to, like, talk bad about anyone.
Of course, yeah.
Mm. But there's some things that, like, you know, maybe it's not your business for me to talk about. But then instead of, like, going to another room, I can just switch the language, you know?
But, Marcelo, because you have this broad view of life and this, it's very practical at the same time. But it's also very motivational and it's also thoughtful how you process each step of life and how you perceive life just in general. right? So how do you define success for yourself, right? And what do you want to give? What is the takeaway that you would like to give to the Indian audience before we end the podcast session?
That's a very, you know, tricky question. But I guess to put in a few words, success for me, you know, like many people see success as something big, so, you know, becoming multimillionaire. Like, I think success for me will be a different success than what Elon Musk considers success. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, I told Faisal this before, that like success for me is more of like, you know, become someone productive for your city, for your country, for the world. Like, instead of having a lot of money in the bank, that like you will never be able to use all of it, you know? Why not have a decent amount of money, some businesses, you know, live a good life, but also help the people in need. So in other words, success for me is more of like, I become successful. Maybe I become an architect in the future. And instead of like making a lot of money and saving that money, I just give jobs to, you know, the people in my family, even maybe a lot of Paraguayan people that are struggling to survive, you know. Like, I think that's success for me. Like, just looking at someone and, you know, just seeing them come to me one day and then they're like, oh, yeah, mm-hmm. I have a house, I have a car, I have a family. My kid goes to college because you gave me the chance to, you know, reach that possibility. That's success for me. So I don't want all the money in the world. I would just, you know. I mean, it sounds, you guys might say, oh, yeah, but, you know, like, that's not success for, like, many people. But, like, I would rather see a bunch of people smiling and thanking me and being happy than, you know, for me to be known as, like, the richest man in the world. I think people, you know, being happy, that makes... You know,
that's the key
that makes anybody rich.
Yeah. I think the way Marcelo explains this is having a sustainable career is way more important than a highly famous career. A sustainable career where everything is sustainable, like there's balance in every aspect.
Yeah.
It makes perfect sense.
But also for Marcelo, it's from at least from what I know about Marcelo so far. Is that happiness and enjoying life, let it be in the bad times, dark times, hard times, good times, is to enjoy each moment of life and take each step positively and defeat it. Right, Marcelo?
Yeah, also, you know, always aiming for the best, you know?
But I forgot to wish you in the beginning of the podcast, but belated happy birthday.
Thank you so much.
I should have brought the cake as well. It's 7 a.m. in the morning, but then there's no bakeries open here. So I wasn't able to get the cake, but you would have a normal cake cutting session here at the podcast as well.
Next time.
Yes, man. Of course. All right. So, thank you so much, Marcelo, for joining with us.
Thank you for the invitation, guys. It was a pleasure. You know, when Faisal told me about this, I was like, do I really want to be there? You know, like, it just sounds like a big responsibility, you know, like talking to people, you know, and sharing an experience is like sometimes, you know, very hard, you know?
I just want to say
thank you for the possibility.
You've done a pretty good job for somebody who hasn't, like, we are as new to podcasting as much as you are new to being invited as a guest. But, like, I think we have done a fair job, I kind of feel, because there was a good dialogue between us, right, to and fro. So, I think I want to thank you from my side again. Thank you for having come over to our podcast and gracing your presence over here, because we really wanted you. And
yeah.
I think... we are very, very pleased to receive that reciprocity from your side. Thank you so much.
Marcelo is that type of person that even if everyone is sleeping in a Zoom meeting, he'll wake everyone up with the way he talks and the personality that he carries. So no one can ever be angry or sad when Marcelo is around. That's actually what we even do sometimes. So if things don't work or if we are all sad, we just meet up together because we all know that Marcelo is going to lit up the mood. So just like it did today. So thanks, Marcelo.
He has an endearing personality. Very very. There's a saying in Hindi, "Bade dil." You say it in "Bade dil." If you know Fazal.
Yeah. It means big-hearted. It means big-hearted, Marcelo.
Big-hearted, yeah.
Yeah.
But the slang is better used in Hindi in our language. But we could call you Bade. We are going to teach you a slang right now. It's called Bade Dil. You are a person
it's
with Bade Dil.
Bade Dil.
Yeah.
My perspective from Indians, even after I met Faisal, was like, you guys are very, very smart and very, very successful. And it's not because you guys are superior or because you guys are blessed by God or like they say about Asians that they literally just have in their genes. I believe that it's more of like the unity and, you know, just you guys always, you know, put your best, you know what I mean? Yeah, from the beginning I saw as Indians as like very smart, and it's not because you guys, you know, have it inside you guys, but because you guys try so hard, you know?
Yeah. After you say this, we're gonna get more likes than dislikes on this video. But Marcelo, again, thanking you. It was very sweet of you to come at 11:30 PM in the night from New York. And very selfish of us to inviting you 7 AM according to our time. But thanks for being here. And thank you everyone for joining to our podcast. And we'll see you in the next episode. Thank you. Thanks again.